Debating Death and Memory, Past and Present. It's an archaeo-death debate.
Hello, I should say first of all. Hello, Rebel Rabbi.
Hi, how are you, Professor?
I'm really excited for this because we've been on my 25K live, and but I wanted it was a very loose discussion, and we're talking about all sorts of crazy stuff, and so I really wanted a more sort of semi-formal structured discussion about, because I thought it'd be really profitable and really interesting for people to hear you and me and our different takes on things and just see where it goes about archaeology and faith, because we're both obviously fans of, you know, like people like Dan McClellan, who are taking down the sort of the nonsense accounts, the, you know, the real crazy false information on this app about, you know, biblical archaeology, the connections of and that kind of thing, and the pseudo archaeologists. We've got Archaeo Wolf and people like that who do great work knocking down these the grifters and the liars and the real fakers. But then between those extremes, there's so much rich, fertile areas for discussion that, you know, we can talk about that isn't just about the, you know, the people that are coming up with all sorts of crazy hypotheses. So that's an important part, but I thought there'd be lots of, there's other things we can chat about, I thought, and I'm just really excited for this.
I would love to. I've been wanting to do this with you for a while, because I do believe wholeheartedly that archaeology and religion intersect, and to think that they don't is, yeah, it's true. I don't have anything to drink because, I mean, that's not true. I have a sweet tea.
Well, it's a little earlier in the day out there in the Wild West or wherever you are, or the Wild
in
Far
the
West.
Wild, well, I'll be honest. I could drink any time of the day. I just,
that's,
you know.
That's true. And so, here in Wales, it's dark and wild and cold, and so I need my skull goblet, and I need my wine.
I've seen that one before. Also, the horn. I've seen you drink out of the horn as well.
This is medicinal wine, cheap little medicinal wine. It's authentic. It's hallowed by antiquity. It's literally, the wine is months old. It goes back to the wild times.
Who do you think is believing that bullshit right now?
I should do TikToks like this, shouldn't I? I should do this with all eerie music and like a candle, and I should go back before the dawn of time in August 2022. Little produced. Sorry, already I'm going off track. Well, I wanted to. I have
That's
some
okay.
questions.
I know you do that. You cut. You babble. It's fine.
But I also, for the listeners, need to know that we do have some questions for each other. We haven't had, we've very rapidly sort of cooked up some questions. So we have a kind of formal structure for this. We're not just going to babble for you. If you stay with us, and I hope you stay with us, we're going to really talk the talk. We're going to set the world to rights, the world of archaeology and faith, aren't we? And we're going to do
yes,
it through a series of questions. But I don't know, how do you want to do this? Do you want to do a question each way, and or do you want to do it just see what happens?
I mean, yeah, we can do a question each way, or if one leads into another,
okay.
And I have an extra question for you that kind of I came up with, and it's going to be a surprise, and we'll see how the professor answers.
Oh no, I knew you'd turn the tables. I knew you'd shift the dynamic.
Well,
I knew.
Let me
it's
just
like
say,
I'm dealing with a
It was a question posed by Allie, who was like, hey, while you're there, ask him this. And I was like, oh, that's a good question. I'm going to have to write that down.
Okay, well, let's hit me. I'm ready for these questions. But also, do you want to go first, or shall I go first and ask you? Because I've got questions.
Whichever
for
you like.
You go first.
Dealer's choice. All right, you want me to ask? You ready?
Hit me with that question.
Let's see. What, if at all, do you think the archaeological record can tell us about faith?
Okay, right. So I suppose from my perspective as an archaeologist, we're the only subject that does deep time, right? Well, the human story in deep time. Obviously, geology, cosmology, you know, the universe, that's a different ballgame. But in terms of the human story, we're the subject that does the deep time human story. Prehistory, you know, 99% of the time that the human species have been on this planet, we haven't left written records. And 99% of the people in history aren't leaving the records that we do have in the times where we do have records. So, you know, archaeology is the subject that is able to chart those big narratives. But we don't only do the big narratives, we also do the micro stories. Archaeologists, when we're excavating settlements, when we're excavating burial sites, when we're excavating an ancient church or an ancient temple, or whether it's a site we can recognize having distinctive features that are to do with faith or religion, or it's just a common place where people grew their crops and kept their goats and lived for centuries. We are able to get into that depth of that rich story of people whose voices are lost to time, whose are not remembered, whose stories aren't told. And we find in the archaeological record, we often can't divide faith from those spaces. Those spaces are not set aside for religious purposes, but people are doing their religion, as often we do, in our homes, in our spaces where we work. Our practices of making things, our agricultural cycles, which vary around the world, greatly depending on the environment. So archaeology, almost all archaeology at one level, is the archaeology of faith, of past people's integration of beliefs and understandings of where they came from, who made them, their relationship with other, divine beings, spirits, ancestors, demons, various different categories of supernatural, preternatural actors, agents. And I think archaeology, therefore, the archaeology of religion is in many ways all archaeology, whether we're looking at trying to answer questions about how people, the most mundane aspects of people's lives, religion is there. So I suppose all archaeology is the archaeology of religion in one sense. And I think, as well as so much of when we're studying past societies, we're not trying to, we can't get inside people's heads. We can't do, we can't time travel. And even if we could time travel, we couldn't literally do sort of, paleo psychology and get inside how people thought. But we can at least reconstruct their practices, what they did, their routines. And that can often reveal clues as to how they may have understood the world, and how their religious systems came into being, developed, and changed. So I suppose my answer is, at one level, everything we do as archaeologists links us to past societies, whether it's the big grand story of the origins of agriculture, or how complex societies evolved, how states collapsed, how people migrated and moved, or the big stories. That is in everything about that is embedded in some kind of religious framework of understanding past people. But then also, when we get into the nitty-gritty of the small stories, the moments and the decades when we can see people, say, replenishing the walls of their house or relaying floors, often those practices of repair and working with space are often, structured around religious ideas about cleanliness or purity or the profane. And so there's so many ways in which archaeologists have, over the decades, tried to access, not into people's past minds, because we can't do that, but into the ways they work with space, material culture, and the landscape. And that can't tell us everything. And that's the frustration of archaeology, is we can never go back. We can never find out the names of the nameless, the voices of the voiceless. We can't do it all, but we can at least start to build up arguments for how past societies engage with religious practice. Now, when we, the final point, just to answer, when we actually get into living traditions that see their descent from these ancient communities, we can, that does often add not only an added poignance to us doing that work, but also it allows us to make analogies and insights from modern, historical texts, sacred texts, from historical sources. We can start to build a picture. But often that can be a blessing, a curse as much as a blessing, because, like, say a monastery in the 6th century CE is not a monastery in the 19th century. So insights from how perhaps Christians think today about monastic space, or how, or modern Jewish communities or other religious communities think it would have worked, can often bring the biases of our modern day onto ancient communities that practice that faith. So we've got to be careful. Those living traditions of faith can be very helpful to inform the past, but they can also lead to misinterpretations if we assume every Hindu in the 3rd century BC, or every Buddhist in the 4th century CE, was in a particular area must have understood the world as Buddhists do today or Hindus do today, that those can be very flattening and distracting. So I suppose it's a blessing and a curse to work with, you know, living traditions of faith and to think through how they interpret the past. So one level, so I suppose that's my answer. It's a very waffly answer, but I want to say that archaeology tells us the big story of the human race, the human past, the human societies. And by doing that, everything we do is about religion in some way, whether it's from Paleolithic cave paintings right up to looking at modern churches and their history of building and so on. But also, we can get into the stories of the mundane, the quotidian, and how ritual is embedded in those localized practices.
I'm gonna tell you something. I accidentally copied the questions that you sent to me to ruminate about what you were gonna ask me, not the ones that I had for you. I realize that now. 'Cause I just realized, no, that was more of a me question. Oh shit, I actually got the wrong ones. So, but you
was
but those were that was a brilliant answer. That was a really brilliant answer. I loved it. I still loved it.
Well,
But
can I ask you the same question then? Because actually, you know,
absolutely.
from a perspective of someone who is a rabbi, you know, you probably get archaeology wafted at you a lot of the time in news information. How do you, what do you want from the archaeological record? What do you want archaeologists? Because you see, you know, we see archaeology misused to make score points in various debates. But you know, when do you feel, you know, what do you want from the archaeological record? Does it matter to you as a modern 21st century rabbi what
Yes.
archaeologists find out?
Well, for me, given that Judaism is such entrenched in our tradition, you know, all you have to do is look into any kind of media that involves Judaism and it's tradition. You know, we want to learn from our past. So for me, as someone who is a rabbi, what I want is to understand the ritual. And a lot of times what happens is pardon me. With discovering archaeological sites, is we learn more about our ritual. We learn how our ritual has preserved through the eons, the last couple thousand years, because we can see there are spaces that the same kind of rituals we were doing thousands of years ago, we have somehow managed to march forward in time to 2022. So for me, the idea that archaeology can back up the ritual of faith, especially as a Jew, is amazingly important to me. But it also shows a way that we have evolved, how our rituals have evolved. You know, you may find ritual tools or ritual sites, and it shows the things we've also stepped away from. You know, you're going to find archaeological sites where we no longer practice animal sacrifice. But at some point we did. So you're going to see these monuments to animal sacrifice. You're going to see these monuments to the Beit HaMikdash, which is the traveling temple, the Mishkan. And so you're going to see these like remnants of that, like buried in the sand, and as it were. And it is a reminder that we are a continuous line of people who have endured for all of these thousands of years. And I think that is very much the way that archaeology can lend context to the way that people kind of resolve their faith. I'm probably babbled, but yeah, that's.
No, I mean, would you say therefore maybe like the ancient sites, ancient monuments, ancient cemeteries that tell of people who followed your faith are therefore like literally material testimony that present a story that has been so many have tried to erase?
Absolutely. I mean, if we think about it, I saw a video of yours, Professor, where you talked about horses being buried with chariots. And it reminded me very much of the Egyptians. The Egyptians, when a pharaoh would die, when someone of consequence would die, they would send in all of their treasure. They would send in their slaves to die with them, believing that they were taking them to the next world with them, that that was part of their faith practice, was when one died. Someone of importance, like I said, a pharaoh or something of the sort, they would send all these items in with them. So then when we see that, we see exactly their faith being enacted, their faith being something that is, well, I believe that this slave person, if they die, if I die with someone who's already dead, if I die with the pharaoh, then I get to go and continue to be the slave to the pharaoh in the underworld. So I think that that really kind of fleshes out, as it were, how ancient faiths and ancient religions started to kind of design the rituals that we have modernized in today's world. So, yes, in a way.
I think someone said this in the chat as well, but I think it's this understanding continuity and change. It's not trying to assert absolute static faith. It's showing the differences, the variations, but the threads, the tangled links of religious practice. Is that a fair, am I getting that right, or is that perhaps more?
Absolutely, absolutely. And I do have a question for you if you're ready.
I'll try.
Okay, so I've noticed that you've mentioned a few times that you are not a religious person. Is that due to your work in the archaeological realm? Is it due to your scientific exploration that has taken away from the idea of being religious? Or just.
That's a really, really interesting question, and you phrased it actually better than you sort of you've gave me a bit of warning that you might be asking something on this, but the way you phrase it is really interesting. So and slightly different from what I'd thought through. So my first point is no, I suppose I was already a bit of a atheist beforehand, but my if anything, my engagement with past societies has cannot but enrich my respect for difference, a cultural difference, and faith differences of faith, and a respect for understanding. Not only because I immerse myself in trying to understand and appreciate past cultures, and to try and see them on their terms rather than my terms, but also I must say because the archaeological community itself does contain many archaeologists of faith. I cannot work within a community and have any intolerance, and I think that's true of any of the current major world religions, but also sort of newer or more personalized spiritualisms. As a student, I was in classrooms at a university. I hadn't really met people before who called themselves pagan until I was a student of archaeology, for example. Of course, I've met people who are perhaps of other faiths, but at school, I was, I went from primary school with Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims. I don't think I had any Jews in my class, but people who professed to be Christian, and that, from the age of, six onwards, I was in a sort of southern British multicultural, relatively multicultural environment, I think. But I hadn't met that community before. And then from there onwards, as a postgraduate and then as an academic, I realized that not only my fellow archaeologists, but also the communities I had to work with. I haven't worked in commercial archaeology, so it's not like clients, but it's more I have worked with local communities and faith groups in local communities. I've worked for church groups. I've and then of course we can't go into the landscape, into built environments of cities, towns, countryside, ancient monuments without encountering people who are there for as tourists, but tourists perhaps also with a faith. I go around churches all the time. I have no religious. I'm impressed by the architecture. I'm impressed by the tombs, which is my thing. But I have to be careful about how I act, how I behave. But also, I get into conversations with people about issues of faith, and I see messages left and prayers said for lost ones, and so one is entering into faith communities in terms of historic spaces, and also working with them, talking with them. But we also have to remember that archaeology, some archaeologists are deeply intolerant, and atheists can be as shitty about this as any other faith group can be in terms of their posturing and statements on this issue. So I have dealt with some of that, and that has only enhanced my respect and appreciation of people of faith for the fact that sometimes archaeologists are equated with some kind of avid or vociferous anti-religious discourse, and I've become, especially because I deal with death and memorialization, I find myself very, very it's difficult to deal with that. I must say I do find that very difficult, and it's only made sure that I work harder myself to not be like that. But we have to remember also that archaeology has a deep and dark history of tying itself to faith. We've worked alongside missionaries as part of the colonial project and the acquisition of archaeological treasures across the world. Not many 19th century archaeologists were clergy, were Anglican from Britain, I'm thinking of here, Wales and England and Scotland and Ireland. Many of them were clergy. Like the archaeology, you look at the list of the archaeological societies when they were new in the 1850s, 1860s, like some massive percentage, like 40, 50% were clergy. And, the patrons would be the Archbishop of Canterbury or the Bishop of Rochester or whatever. This was part of the Anglican elite who were interested in antiquities, partly through a drive of faith. And likewise, their framing of pagan or non-Christian faiths and peoples was heavily, understood in that way as in terms of linear evolution and missionizing and so on. So I think we cannot be archaeologists and pretend we are secular and that we have had, because you're given our deep legacy in the colonial and imperial missions of European nations, and also because we have to work and we have to understand and appreciate faith in the past and in the present. So I suppose that's my kind of answer. And also, I think the most important thing on top of all that is we are contributing to understandings of past faith, landscapes, monuments, buildings, artifacts, graves, cemeteries that are re informing current faith groups and their understandings of their history. And therefore, we are always, in a way, implicated, sometimes in a bad way, sometimes in hopefully in a constructive and positive way in dealing with the stories of faith in the human past. I don't know if that's too, if that makes sense.
No, absolutely, absolutely. But I do have a follow-up question for this.
Yeah.
Is it your atheism that drew you into the specialty of burial and memoriam?
That's a really interesting question because I suppose our collective social secularism has created a 20th century and early 21st century environment where there is no community, not often a community structure for dealing with death and memorialization. So I wouldn't say it's me particularly. I don't know. I'll have to think. That's a really difficult one. I don't know. Maybe. Maybe. I don't know. I've thought about that, but I don't think I've worked it through whether why I got interested in mortuary stuff, other than it's a fascinating, rich body of data with which we can, that has obviously many ethical challenges with it. But I don't know.
Well,
I think that.
I can tell you in terms of ritual from a Jewish perspective, death ritual is very important to Jews because it is part of our life cycle. So we have an entire group of people that are dedicated to the ritual of death. They are called the Hever Kadesha. And these are holy people who take on the work of literally washing the person who has passed. Their job is to come in, say the prayers, they wash this person, they go through the prescribed rituals, they wrap them, and then they stand guard. And it has been a continuous line of what we do in Jewish ritual of death for a thousand years. It's a holy work because you are helping someone in their last journey, as we would say, to Olam Haba, the world to come. And so, the idea and I don't know too many Western religions who still participate in that kind of death ritual. Yes, we have the wakes. You'll see wakes, you'll have funerals, but the idea that there's somebody who's literally their only job is to do this death ritual, wrap the body, and then stand guard. Again, I think that also kind of goes back to the idea of something that is a string that has pulled along from centuries to the mainstream now of 2022.
Without naming names, I can certainly say that archaeologists sometimes find themselves in the field, in field work, almost in that position by accident. Not that they are given a appointed faith role, but we take on a responsibility when we are excavating, analysing in the lab, and writing. At every stage of our process, we are We're a kind of secular version of that. We are kind of death dealers, and I've talked about that in publications, that we are kind of death dealer in the sense of, not in the underworld sense of
I was just
Caitlin
gonna
Dunsdale,
say that sounded very, that sounded like a callback to Underworld.
no black leather or anything like that, but we do
Oh, hold
that's
on a
very
second.
much what
Wait, hold on, hold on. I'm trying to
that.
picture a lot of archaeologists
No.
now going around in black leather.
But in various no. Anyway, but I'm serious. We do take on this role of mediating, and I won't name names, but I know a very eminent American archaeologist who has had that role in her Jewish community, as well as being, through her career, a field archaeologist excavating cemetery sites of other faiths, of other multicultural ethnic communities in the American Southwest and in California. And it makes me think about, there is this intersection between archaeologists who fit take on a responsibility to tell the stories of the ancient dead and to deal with their remains. And it may be in a scientific context, but it is a context where there is care, there is respect, there's need for care and respect. And there's only a few, particularly disgusting and gratuitous archaeological moments in recent times. There's a few I've been seeing in America of people who deliberately, for political agendas, mock that and abuse that. Well, a lot of archaeologists have, for many generations of archaeologists, have been deeply aware of this. We haven't often articulated it, which is one of the reasons I've been writing about it, because it's almost like a secular version of that. And one of the ways in which I've seen that actually happen is in a very famous case on a TV documentary with the excavation of the grave of Richard III, where Joe Appleby was in the grave excavating it, and Philippa Langley, who is obviously heralded as the heroine of the new film that's come out about that grave, sort of is going, "Oh, it's Richard III," and is draping a flag over his. And Joe Appleby's response was, "We don't know this yet." And she wasn't simply frustrated by her jump to conclusion, which proved to be right, that it was the brains of Richard III. This is my interpretation. I haven't talked to Joe about this, but Dr. Joe Appleby at the University of Leicester seemed to be angry at her abuse of the remains, because, and from knowing, being a mortuary archaeologist myself, if someone literally, as the remains were coming out, was trying to identify them without proper scientific process, it's not a snobby, "Oh, you don't know, we have to do our tests and we'll tell you." It wasn't that. She was frustrated by the fact that the dead were not being respected, because if that had turned out to be another 13th or 14th century individual, immediately attributing it an identity that wasn't that person could have, is a, an act of disrespect, I think. And I think that's where Joe, I'm not putting words in her mouth, this is my inference, just for viewers to make clear, but that's a good example, I feel, of how archaeologists do really take it seriously. That we're not appointed in any faith group, and we often have to work with the remains of people whose faith are unknown, or faith is clearly not ours, because it's a long dead faith, or it's a faith that is, different from the pro. And we take that very, very seriously in terms of how we treat those remains. And we often try to resist those that would happily bulldoze the remains or treat them differently.
I love it. I think that's a great answer. I appreciate the insight so much.
But I haven't really answered about whether your follow-up question, but I'll have a think about whether, did I go into death because of my atheism so much, and I need to sort of find something? I don't know. That's a lot to unpick there. I might need to go into therapy
Yeah,
to.
I just completely, I didn't mean to sideline you with that,
No.
but the way you were explaining it earlier, it really for me was like, I wonder if there's a correlation between the two for you.
May I ask you a question?
Absolutely. I'm ready. I'm probably not, but I'm gonna try.
We've talked about, what do you want from archaeology, and I was interested in how should archaeologists talk to people of faith about their research and expertise, and what are the definite no-nos? Have you encountered any definite bloopers on, from my personal experience, or from, whether it's archaeologists, historians, or whatever? I'm just interested in, what your sense is of how we talk about the human past and human stories and faith.
I think that, in my opinion, this is a great question. Great question. I think that from the perspective of someone who is a member of a well, a minority faith. I think one of the things is to make sure that when you're interacting with someone who is of faith, that you are not degrading their faith while trying to get at the truth. Because in my personal experience, I will have people say, well, let's take the Torah, for example, because I'm a Jew, and of course, I'm aware that the Torah is not a historical record. People in the comments can come at me later on if they'd like to, but I'm aware that the Torah is not a historical record. There is no way that our world is 5,788 years old. It just isn't. And if anyone actually took time to do the math, just the begats that happen in Genesis is longer than 5,000 years. So, but what will happen is people in scientific communities will often say, because it's not a historical record, why do you need it? What is the point of it? Why don't you just discard it and only loons still have faith? If you were actually a scientific person, you would not have this faith. You would just be like, you understand this is it. This is all there is. That's all you need to go by. And the frustrating part is the Torah is not supposed to be a historical record. It is supposed to be there to help people cope with their everyday living life day to day. It isn't supposed to be there to provide historical context. It is supposed to be there. Its reason is to help people understand how to thrive in difficult times, how to have hope in difficult times, and how to get through every day. It isn't there to be held up. And so I think when we talk to people who are in any kind of historians, archaeologists, my request would be to take a moment, step back, and realize that the people that you whom you are speaking with have this deep held faith. And when you, I don't want to say mock, because I would like to think that no one is actually mocking the faith. But when you sort of say, well, how could you believe that? There's so much evidence that Noah's Ark never existed. Like, we've never found it. That what you are doing is harm rather than help. We know. Everyone knows that no, I mean, no, I know there are some people who believe that people rode dinosaurs. I'm aware of that.
I
But
want it
for
to
the
be true. I
most part,
want to ride a dinosaur.
of course you do. Yes, of course you do.
No, but seriously, I think so. I know what you're
Yeah, I
saying.
think that the biggest thing is to understand that our faith has mostly been hard won. Anyone's faith is. Our faith is constantly tested, and that when we have to go into spaces, like I've gone into spaces with historians who love to point out the inaccuracies of the Torah, and I'm like, pardon my Hebrew, motherfucker, you think I don't know? Of course I know this. That's my job is to know this. But that doesn't take away from our faith. So to kind of sum up and try to answer your question is just to recognize that two things can be true. I can have this faith and understand that it's not historically accurate.
Yes, and I think, yeah, I can only but agree that there's no point, there's no fact checking or gotcha moment that ever the archaeological record or the archaeological inquiry is going to provide to people, unless, and I don't know why people, and I suppose that's it works two ways though, isn't it? That's why I think it's healthy and important that we also counter those that try to say, here's an archaeological site, therefore this proves the
That people
some.
rode dinosaurs.
Well, yeah, it was
And I
certainly
believe that
some things we
happens
can.
more often in the United States. I would like to take a moment to apologize to the rest of the world because I'm well aware that Texas is mostly responsible for the idea that people were riding dinosaurs. They believe it's there in the Torah, and when we find dinosaurs, they literally have this belief that, oh, well, people were walking alongside, even though paleontologists have told us that's not the facts. There's just no scientific evidence to suggest otherwise, but faith is a hard thing to play with people. And I do believe, and I'm going to add to this, I do believe that what happens is the more that you tell someone their faith is wrong, sometimes the more they dig in. I mean, how do you think we end up with cults? The more that you tell someone, no, you're wrong, they want so much not to be wrong. They kind of like dig in like a tick and say, well, forget what you say. I'm going to live this life, and now I'm going to be the best version of this type of faith that there is. And I think ultimately it is an unfortunate and harmful thing that happens to people of faith because they cannot resolve the fact that their faith has nothing, doesn't have to have anything to do. It doesn't have to be like embedded in imperial fact.
So I think we accept that Texas is to blame for most things. Okay, that's fine. And various other count and other states of the United States are being mentioned in the comments. But I do wonder whether I was talking to my students about this today about contrarian. If you so I think some archaeologists are literally experts at pissing people off. I mean, I know I've met them. I've met people who've literally turned a good-natured meeting with a reverend in a parish churchyard into an argument. You know, out of they have the ability. It's a deliberate preened academic pomposity. But I also see it in U.S. academia too. Is that this? Let's put it this way: some academics takedowns of you know showing of fact checking religion lead almost make me want to, as I'm a contrarian, make me want to suddenly profess a faith just to react because it's so, and I think that if I'm feeling that as an academic, how is that going down with the people they think they're criticizing? And I think, yes, I think a lot of the time because they're playing to an audience just to aggrandize themselves, they're not thinking what they're actually doing is fostering some of the more extreme or unusual or odd or dangerous aspects of not necessarily faith but of misinformation or confused thinking about the human past, and that's why I think sometimes we do more harm than good. And I think that's what you seem to be saying too, is that or it can be, you know, we can perhaps overplay our hand and just create more hostility and more.
I think it's just a fine line to walk, and I appreciate how difficult that line is. I think it's also a fine line that any of us here in our, my line of work walks when we're trying to work in conjunction with archaeologists, because we're also trying not to, we're trying to maintain our faith while being faced with these things. So sometimes for me, I'm one who can understand that science and faith can coexist peacefully if it needs to. But I know rabbis, personally know rabbis who believe that the world is 5,788 years old and would be faced with archaeological evidence and say, "No, you're wrong. It's a lie, it's made up." So I also understand there are problematic people on my end also who refuse to understand that there's, and will argue. Just as you were saying that archaeologists maybe will argue with priests and other members of the faith, I know rabbis who would be in this room with you right now telling you that you were full of chutzpah, and how dare you, even question the word of Hashem, and it's a sur, and you're a kilul Hashem, and like just be for those who don't speak Hebrew, that you are like an affront to God, things like that. So I think that there's room for both sides to somehow meet in the middle, and it's just finding that happy medium that I hope happens.
But Rabbi, I've never got into an argument with a rabbi, but I have got into argument with Tolkien acolytes. You know, I think people
Well,
saw some
I'm
have
happy to
to
argue
that
with
false
you if that's
god.
what you need. If you're thinking to yourself, I've never argued with a rabbi, we could do that. Like, I'm sure I could find something. Well, I'm a
I
rabbi.
wouldn't.
With arguing is like I have a master's degree in debate just by being a Jew. And as you said, and I'm not proselytizing here, but you did say sometimes it makes me want to proclaim a faith. The Jews will take you. Like, it's fine.
Okay, sign me up. But no, seriously, it is a very it is a very sort of you know it is a very sort of e easy to get into arguments that go nowhere. But it's really I don't mind a healthy banter, but when it's you know it's since most social media discussions amongst even academics is basically, well, I disagree with you. Well, I don't like your face. And that's about the level you get, isn't it? You know, and you think, oh, right, okay, I thought this was going to be a conversation about a particular archaeological site. Yeah, so's your face. Oh, well, okay, right, now, there's not much I can do about that, then, is there? You know, and that's about the level it gets to. So, but no, it's really, yeah, I see someone say, watch out, Howard, I wouldn't win, I don't think, very, this kind of argument. But no, I think it's really interesting because I was talking to my students literally today about this very issue, about how archaeologists generally do cause more trouble. I gave them a piece of reading to do from an American archaeologist who's very good on these issues of pseudo archaeology, and I agree with most of what he wrote. I gave it to my students, and my students said, "My word, this is so pompous." I said, "And it's written like 2021, 22. It's not like 1960s or 1970s. This is brand new piece of writing." I said, "Why do you think it's pompous? You know, just the way he talks about non-educated or non-academic people, it's just really patronizing." They said that to me, and I said, "I was wondering if you'd say that or not. I didn't know what they would get out of it, you know, or they'd just go, yeah, he's dead right, let's hammer those ancient alien freaks." And I mean, I agree with him on, you know, I don't have any sympathy with some of the more extreme and dangerous, pernicious narratives out there, but equally, there's ways of doing it, isn't there? And I'm not saying I get it right, I'm just saying it's a problem, you know. They're saying you can't, they can't hear you, but I can hear you, so I don't know what, I don't know if that's, yeah, so she's going to pop out and pop back in if you see if it'll fix it, because it's I can hear her, but obviously it's a broader issue with the connection. But I'm in terms of how to deal with, I'm just gonna give me a chance to actually think about how to answer a question, because I think it's a really important question about how do I deal with people of faith in a variety of a variety of backgrounds. And particularly the first point I would say for listeners is that there's at least two types of pagan that I mainly deal with. Three, really. There's sort of the Celtic pagans, or the Welsh, Irish pagan, Scottish pagan, sort of who are interested in Celtic mythology and their interest and affinity with and druidry and Wiccans and that kind of thing. And that all that sort of stuff tends to be, I interact with that when I'm talking about prehistoric sites or early historic sites in Western Britain, with holy wells that are Christian, often places of worship for people who believe they had an earlier pagan view. So I do interact with individuals with those kind of faiths, and that is usually healthy and easy. Although there are some in those communities who have very strong hyper-nationalist and racialized views of the Celtic past too. I usually negotiate those quite easily and find people are happy to deal with those things. I do have to invite you back in, except there we are. Sorry, I didn't. Then the second type of, I was just talking about the different types of paganism that I deal with. So Celtic paganism is one. The other one is the Norse pagans, and I'm a Viking period archaeology specialist, but I've encountered them more. Actually, in the archaeological communities, archaeologists who are Norse pagans, more than, well, before TikTok, this is, before dealing with actual non-archaeology Norse pagans. And they're the biggest group I deal with now, and I have contacts with, and I've got a lot of respect for them. But there are elements of some very naive thinking there, and some real challenges there. The most problematic of all, though, I think, are the Anglo-Saxon pagans, or the old Germanic pagans, some of who are great, and some of them are. But they are very much, they tend to be even more purist and with folkish sympathies to a much more racialized and ethnocentric view, ethno-nationalist view of the early Middle Ages, and they can be of all backgrounds and interests. And then I suppose there's also the paleo-Christians, the, you know, the early Christian, people who like early Christianity or into the early church. And they tend to be like, you know, like the planet Earth, mostly harmless in Douglas Adams' terms. But there can be a sort of very benign, well, seemingly benign, but very pernicious nationalism and racialization of Englishness within that Christian faith. But that's more about local communities that have an ancient church and are very much into, they're all sort of very posh and middle, you know, Middle England areas. You know, we, you know, our church was founded by some Cuthbert there, and it's not. But so that's the fourth group. Let's keep sticking to the pagans. It's the three groups: the Celtic, the Old Germanic or Anglo-Saxon, and then the Norse. And I suppose they all have different permutations and interests within that. But I suppose that I've encountered these for over 25 years. You know, ever since I've been researching. And on one level, they're our greatest allies, because they're people who care about these ancient sites. They care about the material culture. They're deeply, some of them are deeply effective and well-read scholars in their own right. And I have a lot of respect for them. But they're also the potential amongst these individuals, a very deep-seated, you know, ethno-nationalist and white, therefore white supremacist thinking about the origins of Englishness and the origins of the Viking origins. And I think we've seen that on TikTok, and we see that it's not worse on TikTok. I think it's the same as what I've encountered at conferences and talks. There's always, I've been in some talks in my archaeological career, I'm talking to a room, the Sutton Hoo Society, right? The Sutton Hoo site, the famous Anglo-Saxon burial site. I did a talk to the Sutton Hoo site. Like, you know, you could split the room in three. In the middle of the room, there's about 50 people who are just Joe Public, you know, British public, just rocked up to a conference for a day to see some academics talk. Then on one side, I mean, they weren't split this way, but I'm just giving you a sort of visual. On one side, you've got the county sets, you know, they've got pictures of, you know, the Queen on their mantelpiece, and their average salary is about that, you know, is you know, would we, you know, they probably own half the county, you know, they're very posh, and they come up to you and go, oh, we're fascinated by the origins of English royalty, you know, and they're that way inclined. And then you've got the Mjolnirs and the various types of plaited or dreaded hairs and beards and types who go, ah, I clocked you, you're probably, you know, and I mean, it's not that easy, I don't do that, but you know, you've got a group of people who are in it for the faith, they're in it for the for that side, and of those people, some lovely, informed, intelligent people, but there's also some crazies, and but there can be crazies in all those groups, to be fair. But and I suppose that's the challenge, is not being prejudiced or presume, and to realize that people are in this for a variety of personal reasons, I suppose. So I suppose I don't have an answer of how I deal with it. I take people as individuals and I try to respond to their interests. No,
I think that's
prejudice.
A very good answer. I think, well, coming from me, if you've watched any of my videos, then you'll see that I'm definitely one of those, you should meet people where they are. So I think that's an excellent point that you make, that you take people by individualism, because I definitely believe if we put everyone into one to these distinct categories, we're missing out on, like, either helping to enlighten people. You know, I don't believe that anyone is without merit. So even the most naive person, I think that sometimes they're not without merit, and we just need to be able to have patience. That's the issue I have sometimes,
if you can think about it, gateways into, not faith, but gateways into the archaeological record, faith can be one of them, in the same way that reading a fantasy novel can get a lot of people get into early medieval archaeology, get into it through Arthuriana, through Merlin, or, you know, stories of Arthur, or the original, you know, the not the original stories, but perhaps just the TV program Merlin, you know, and that's enough. I don't care. As long as you're interested in, well, what happened in the Dark Ages, we can work with that. We can build on that, can't we? There's nothing stopping you. If you come, and I don't go, you stupid idiot, you think that the Riders of Rohan are the way that the Mercians conducted their warfare? Well, I can tell you. Like, no, it's not. It's ridiculous. No one. It's great. It's great that there are people interested. But some of them you do have to accept after some trying. There's no point. There's no way this is going to work. You know, they
May
are.
I just they, say... on a personal level, mine was the story of Tristan and Isolde.
There you are.
Oh, yay! That was what I was going to ask, is if I could be heard. Yeah, for me, Tristan and Isolde was, like, what got me into Arthurian legend, and then kind of, like, cascaded from there. And if I may also say, I have a soft spot for Brian Boru. I do, I do. In fact,
brought it up at the last live with my Guinness can and the harp of Brian Boru. It's a symbol of Guinness.
One of his wives named Gormley. She was his second wife and thought to be a witch. I was completely fascinated with her for years and years and years. Just
I didn't know about this.
Completely fascinated with her. And it made me start looking into all of like that time period and everything. And it just, yeah, so I agree with you. And I feel the same way about faith and about religion, you know. It could be very well some movie that somebody saw or some book somebody saw where someone describes their deep and unending faith that makes them start to look into what religion is and what faith actually entails. So it's amazing what thing can flip the switch and get someone interested in something like that.
And I can tell you, right, honestly, without saying I'm religious at all, but I felt some places, some visits to archaeological sites, ancient sites, holy sites, have filled me with an immense sense of something, you know, a sense of reflection and peace, or, you know, a whole variety of different reactions. But places inspire, and they inspire thinking, they inspire emotions. And archaeologists should and can and do, I think, a lot of archaeologists do tap into that, try and draw on that to and if we somehow, if our main mode of operation is denouncing and dismissing and deriding people's passions and interests and emotions and spiritual connections to place, it can be quite it's not constructive, it's not healthy as a discipline, but also on a human level it's not even ethical. I don't know if I told you this or someone else in a live at some point. There have been humorous interactions I've seen between archaeologists and people trying to interact with the spiritual sense with an ancient monument. Can I tell you one anecdote? Was when I was a student and I was surveying the Clava Cairns, which are now known to be early Bronze Age passage graves near Inverness. And they are famous because they are near the Culloden battlefield site, which is incidental, but they're just on the tourist route for a North American, you know, tourists and so on. And we were doing an archaeological survey there with an old-fashioned total, well, it's now old-fashioned total station, which had for the strength of the signal, it had an audio signal to tell you how strong the signal was between the machine and the pole where you're holding it to do the survey, which was a laser. And it would have a change of pitch when it had a stronger signal. So we had a little signal going, right? And we were working all day with this, doing the survey of the site with this little noise going on, because it was the way we could tell that the machine had found the pole so that we could then take the reading. And it was also a site that's really popular with certain new age group who come have a like commune in Nairn or something, and they come out and they meditate amongst the stones, which is fine, let them do that, and it's great. It's another way in which those monuments have an active meaning in the modern community, is that people come there, you know, for a whole tourists come there, people come there for spiritual reasons. But apparently, and this is the anecdote, that after about 4 hours, this guy strode up to the archaeological technician who worked for the university and the students that were there and went, "It's you!" And she went, "Sorry?" And she went, "It's your blimmin' machine making that noise. I thought I was connecting to another plane." And she said, "No, it's just our machine. What it's, you know," and explained what it was doing. And he was absolutely livid. So he spent four hours or something trying to be peaceful and calm.
He was in a trance.
And then he was just the rage. So it's like Victor Meldrew, if you've seen One Foot in the Grave. It's you! You know, sort of this anger, you know, because we had ruined his experience. More than that, we're not ruining the experience. We had duped him somehow. Or, you know, it was our fault that he thought that, you know. Yeah, so you get some moments that are quite funny. But we, you know, we didn't laugh at him. You know, we just went, "Oh, you know, sorry. It's just our machine." But anyway, sorry, I just went off on an anecdote about that. But what was that in
You
answer
know
to?
what? The thing is I'm used to this. This is Professor Howard Williams. I'm aware. I knew that when I signed on. When you said, you know, I have this great idea, I think this is a wonderful idea, I knew what I signed up for. It's fine.
Well, can I ask you a question then again?
Absolutely. Ask away.
And it's about, archaeologists get very upset, as I've already discussed this, about the pseudo archaeology and being a great evil. In that, some archaeologists are very almost evangelistic against pseudo archaeology because it is a nightmare, dealing with these massive accounts spewing this, horse manure, when it actually overwrites indigenous communities, and it can be deeply pernicious in its, when you have indigenous communities trying to fight for land rights and recognition, and all you've got are these big accounts spewing horse manure about their ancient sites. And I understand the passion and the anger amongst archaeologists and indigenous people, but from your perspective, which kinds of pseudo archaeology, or do you think, are most dangerous? And again, this is something I talked with my students today about, because they asked me, well, is all this pseudo archaeology, is it mostly harmless, or when does it become dangerous? And I wondered whether, from your perspective, is it ancient aliens, or is it American Christians claiming to do biblical archaeology? And what do you, if as a person of faith, do you think this, does this matter as much as archaeologists think it does? And if it does, what kinds of pseudo archaeology do you think are the most dangerous?
This is an excellent question, and I'm going to gear up for a long one, and I apologize for that.
I knew that. Good.
I live in America, right? So like right off the bat, we're shit. I'm sorry, but that's the truth. Honestly, I do not see in other countries the prevalency of pseudo archaeology that I do in the Americas. I just do not. I live in a place where people, as I said earlier, believe with their entire being that men rode dinosaurs. And I think that that does not only a disservice to people of faith, but I think it lowers the IQs of people in general. I'm sorry. And yes,
Also offensive to the dinosaurs.
it is not only that, it's like they want the dogma to match the data, and they're going to make that happen however they have to, and forget that the data does not actually tell them this. The data does not support the idea that humans lived at the same time that dinosaurs did. We don't have that. But they dig through the Bible. This is what gets me. And this is where, for me, I get straight up unhinged, kind of angry. They'll dig through the Bible and say, well, the Torah says there were sea monsters. So clearly that meant dinosaurs. No,
Okay.
it didn't. It could have, no, it didn't. It could have meant anything. We have proof that this didn't happen at the same time. And again, I go back to the Torah is not a historical record. The New Testament is certainly not a historical record. There's literally no proof, and I'm about to piss off a lot of Christians, that Jesus ever existed. No proof whatsoever. But
No comment.
people who have the faith in Jesus is fine. If that's what you believe, that's fine. But it's dangerous. And I'm sorry, I get, hold on. You just breathe for a second.
I know he existed. He was on a Christmas card last year, so I know it happened. Okay. Sorry, go on, go on. Sorry, I interrupted. Go on. I'm being silly.
I get so overly angry because it is a dangerous narrative to push. Are you comfortable? Like I noticed you're okay. So yeah,
I might
it
move in a
is
minute,
a
actually. You talk, I might move my screen because I want to stand up a bit and dance around. I'm a bit too static
okay.
here. Yeah, you go on.
So it is a dangerous narrative. It is so dangerous to push these narratives onto people. It is so dangerous to raise children to believe this. No, the world is exactly 5,000 years old. It actually gets my ire up. Like I can feel like my blood pressure rising when people say these things to me. And I just, oh, I think aliens I actually can handle better. When people start talking about aliens, I'm kind of like, okay, I can deal with the idea that somebody believes that we are not alone in the world, that the truth is out there, as it were. I can understand that. I mean, to me, it seems scientifically impossible to think that we are the only planet that has ever developed any sort of life anywhere. So I can totally get behind that. The idea that ancient aliens are the people who built the pyramids, that pisses me off. You know, that's not, ooh.
You
The
see,
same
that's
also with the narrative. The same with the narrative that the idea that Israelites were actually the ones who built the pyramids. There is scientific evidence that the Egyptians built the pyramids.
yeah.
We did not build the pyramids. It is a parable to allow us to understand our faith. It is not scientific fact. But again, we have those people who want to make it fit. And so they'll sit there and they'll just wedge it in there until they can. It's like a puzzle piece that you're just like, no, I'm done with this puzzle. So I'm just gonna, until it fits. All right, I'm done. I'm just gonna, whew, that one's that one's one that gets me kind of upset.
But I was talking to my students about this today, is that while for archaeologists and indigenous communities, ancient aliens is nothing but pernicious and dangerous and embedded in racist ideology, and I'm not disputing that, just to make absolutely clear for listeners, for astrophysicists, including my brother, got a degree in astrophysics, and he did his final degree on extraterrestrial hypothesis of extraterrestrial life. For many scientists, and particularly astrophysicists, this is not only just a bit of public PR that there's all these lovely TV shows with fictional outer space worlds. It's actually a very plausible likelihood there's other living sentient beings somewhere in the vast, huge expanse of the universe. And so I have a real problem with it's about wondering where in which context. It's about making remembering, and I think some archaeologists forget, it depends on who you're talking to and where really makes a difference, and that some of these stories can be constructive and useful in getting people in the door of a conversation that then you can say, well, of course we have no freaking evidence of ancient aliens, but there's actually some really interesting things. Whereas some of the things that perhaps from an American perspective are on the sidelines of pseudo-archaeology, like for me, dealing with the early Middle Ages, the pseudo-archaeology is often within the perceptions and stereotypes of the Vikings. It's nothing to do with ancient aliens, or it's to do with the perceptions of the early English and where they came from. And that is actually being mobilized by extremist groups who want to literally harm people and manipulate politics. Ancient aliens isn't in that way. And so it's really difficult to, I'm not saying that the American perspective is wrong. I'm just saying we have to remember where and how this plays out and how it can affect different communities. And biblical archaeology would be one that I would imagine is, so, exhausting and frustrating to deal with. So I don't know. I just.
And I get faced with that a lot. Biblical archaeology is one of the bigger arguments that I have in the religious community, especially among other members of the clergy. Luckily, I surround myself mostly with a lot of progressive clergy that we have moved beyond this kind of idea that every word in Torah is there for a reason, and every dot and every, Kirikou and every cancellation mark is actually there for a reason. But there are still quite a bit out there that use it to try and push this idea. And even in my own faith, the idea of biblical archaeology is a thing. And I'm just like, I learned the same thing you did. Like we have the same text. We read the same Talmud. We have the same rituals. How did you get there? And I got over here. How did that? Howard, when I tell you.
I mean, I was trying to think of positive. I said to my students today about how I can tell you, let me just pitch something, and I may be wrong, and someone may rightly come at me and say, Howard, you've misunderstood this. But there are relatively, not completely benign, there are relatively benign pseudo-archaeologists. Like in all of, and one of them that I think is particularly benign, and I don't think is going to cause a lot of harm, is ghost hunters or ghost mediums, people who think that places and objects have spiritual qualities. There's very few times that those kind of beliefs are going to harm the archaeological record or be manipulated, use the, manipulate the archaeological record to do harm to marginalized groups. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think that there has been a long history of spiritualism in archaeology, amongst archaeologists too, and motivating archaeological inquiry. And I think the Richard III grave can be a more recent example, although maybe that's a slight mischaracterization. But there are also, from Sutton Hoo, the excavation at Sutton famous Anglo-Saxon burial site was motivated in part by Edith Pretty losing her husband and imagining she saw riders riding around the burial mounds on her property that inspired her to get Basil Brown in to excavate them. And just giving you an example that so sometimes spiritualism does lead to interventions and that can damage archaeological sites. But I think most cases, I think, people doing a bit of a spooky tour of a downtown neighborhood isn't going to harm
Oh,
anyone or
yeah.
anything.
No, I
Or,
don't think that's harmful at all. I think when we move into the harmful parts is when people prey on people using those kinds of techniques to further their own kind of pockets. I think that's where I would draw the line. But I do have a question for you.
oh.
If you, what would be one holy religious site that you would love to be able to do field research on that you haven't?
I don't know. I've been thinking about this. When I had notes on this, I had a
You have
long.
notes.
I have notes. I have notes. I had. So I think. I mean, one level, I don't have an easy answer, and I was going to say that I've already been working on various sacred and holy sites, directly and indirectly through desk-based research, through library-based research, and also by visiting. There's many ways that we can do archaeological investigations in holy sites without. Archaeology isn't always intervention and destruction, right? So archaeology is often salvage, archaeology is often non-intrusive techniques. So there's many ways we can investigate sacred sites without disrupting them or disturbing them. And one of, I mean, I've already done a project on English and Welsh cathedrals and their tombs. And so I've already worked on that, and a lot of that hasn't been published, although I did supervise a doctoral thesis to public to completion on that by one of my, obviously one of my former doctoral students, who's now a PhD, and now she's got a lectureship, and she's very good. So I've worked on holy sites. I mean, one site that I would love to do work on, and I never will probably, because I've worked on a site called the Pillar of Eliseg, which is a Bronze Age barrow that had a early Christian cross, a 9th-century cross put on it, which is a I could talk about for hours. But there's a I've got a whole project website if anyone wants to look up the Pillar of Eliseg or Eliseg, Elisede, and but it's in a landscape we know nothing about, and nearby, 4.5 centuries after this cross was raised, in about 845, 850 AD. In the 13th century, at the end of the 13th, the beginning of the 13th century, sorry, the Cistercians were granted land nearby at a site called Llangwestl to build a monastery. And so it became one of hundreds of Cistercian monasteries we have across Europe, from Sweden to Finland to Poland to obviously Italy, France, but Germany, what areas that become those modern nations, I mean, and England and Wales and Scotland. And an island. So in other words, the Cistercians are like the later medieval, one of these many monastic orders, that like medieval corporations. They have branches in every part of Europe, And did the Cistercians get into the Holy Land? I can't remember. But anyway, the point is they are founding, monastic orders, and they're getting land given to them by local royalty, local king. But they put their monastery on a place that was known in the documents as Llangwestl. And Llan is a holy site, means the holy site of St. Gwesteth. And we don't know who St. Gwesteth is or what Gwesteth means, as far as I understand. But it's right next to this cross that I've been investigating. It's like literally within eyesight of it. And there's this ruin of this beautiful monastery that existed from the 13th century through to Henry VIII, wanted another wife, just, left the Catholic Church, caused, centuries of mayhem, but in the process got rid of all the monasteries, right? So we got this lovely monastic ruin which attracted tourists. Well, the first tourist trail in England and Wales was to Valley, went up the Vale of Llangollen to Valacrucis Abbey. So it was the first tourist route before even Scotland and the Cumbria, the Lake District became tourist attractions. It was Wales. In the Napoleonic Wars, when English toffs couldn't go to Italy anymore because Napoleon was in the way, Wales became the thing. So, this ruin became really iconic in Welsh identity and so on. But there's so much we don't know about. Was there a monastery underneath? And yes, there's the nonsense theory. The Holy Grail was buried there, and there's a book written about it, and modern fringe crazy ideas about the ruins of Valacrucis Abbey, which simply means the Valley of the Cross, the Abbey in the Valley of the Cross, and the cross in question is the already ancient cross of the 9th century that I've investigated. So my answer to your question is, what holy site would I like to investigate? I think there's in some fantasy world where I had the time and money to, and the permission, which would be very difficult, and the safety because it's modern ruin. It's like the ruins are 15. Well, what's the highest part of the church there? About 9, 10 meters. So it's not safe. But there is must be an early medieval site, an earlier holy site under that church that, but we will never know because they built over it in the 13th century. So I suppose that's an
May I
answer
ask you a
for you.
follow-up question?
Yes.
My follow-up question is, if by chance there was a fantasy relic, something that does not actually currently exist on planet Earth, but there was one that you were able to actually find and say, I found this, whether it was, the Holy Grail or the Sword in the Stone or something like that. What would be the one that you would hope that Professor Howard Williams would stumble upon and be the finder of this beautiful fantasy, oh my gosh, no, this was in legend and it actually exists.
It's my birthday. It's my precious. No, you mean I mean an object from not from like you
No,
said
it could be anything. And
the one
I'm
ruin.
ex
I would keep
Is
it
it
as an
really?
heirloom of my house.
You
I
would
wouldn't put.
not it, why did I why would I think that it was the I should have known it would be the one ring. I should have known this. Your obsession with Tolkien knows no end.
I would keep it safe in the darkest, deepest vaults, only to use. At
In
the
Mordor, with the
most,
deepest, darkest vault in Mordor.
like Denethor says, only to use it in the most direst of need. I would
See,
never
and mine
misuse.
would be either the Holy Grail, but that's because of Indiana Jones. I'm not gonna lie. That's straight up Indiana Jones. Or the Sword in the Stone.
I haven't really thought. This is a great question. Is there any real holy? I mean, there's the Indiana Jones options, yes, and you have chosen wisely. No, I mean, so been.
That was good. That's
Oh,
oh, I was gonna
no,
say that's a good accent, but then I remembered your English.
exactly. You've chosen wisely. No, but are there any other sort of relics? I hadn't really. God, that's a really great question. I think if I just forget the One Ring, I'd like one of these swords from Gondolin. I'd like was it Glamling or something like that? I'd like one of these. So just go to a troll hoard and find a sword of the first age, whip it out, slay about 1,000 gazillion goblins. That'd be cool. That'd be cool. I don't know if that counts as a sacred object, more of an ancient heirloom, but they'd be cool. Or if I was going to be honest, another one, a palantir. If we're in Middle Earth, get a palantir. So much. Who'd need TikTok when you've got a palantir? As long as you don't know who's watching, though, I suppose. Maybe there's a.
This is true.
There could
I
be
mean, but
Putin
if
or
we're being
Trump.
honest, you don't know who's watching on TikTok either, so.
Oh shit!
Yeah,
A Viking. I don't know why that's relevant, but I just thought I'd show you. He's sitting on there. That's Andy, my Manx Viking. He sits on the shelf and watches my work. So I have many eyes watching me, but they're just stuffed toys in this my little archaeo den. But no, there's a serious point, isn't it, about surveillance and Tolkien's world of surveillance. I'm sure there's a better answer I could have, but my brain is addled by why now. But I think the one true ring or some other ancient heirloom of the First Age.
I think
the
that's
Ark of
a
the
great
Covenant,
question.
Too much trouble,
Great.
I see
See,
someone
I thought about doing. See, and the thing is, the Ark of the Covenant I was thinking of, but given that I understand the way Jews believe what's in the Ark of the Covenant, and you're going to melt your face off, like, no, thank you. I do not want to find the Ark of the Covenant. Because that's how we see it. Judaism teaches that inside the Ark of the Covenant is the Shekinah, the divine presence of God. And no mortal can withstand the divine presence of God, and then melt your face off. And I really don't want my face melted off, so. But I would like to rule England as the king. So finding the sword and the stone, man, that would do it for me. I think I'm worthy. I think I could just like rip that right out of there and go to it. I would be like, yes, I am. Forget King Charles. Here comes Queen Hannah. Now you're in trouble.
Well,
there goes the Church of England.
Well, we've had a Jewish Prime Minister before, so
this
we should have a, you know, not recently, but you know, but we, you know, that you know, it's all a matter of time. But I think that's. I have a question for you. I should go back to my question, should I? Is that are we finished? Are we got? You want me to suggest some more crazy
No,
things?
Go right ahead. Go ahead. I have one last question for you, but I go ahead. Ask me first.
So I was actually going to ask what your impression. Maybe you don't know enough about the archaeological community, but do you think, you know, a lot of archaeologists are people of faith? You know, and I think that's important for the audience to hear, is that there is not. And I said it before.
Not
in my
everyone is an atheist.
I don't want to give people the stereotype that, you know, and many people won't talk about it, and they won't talk about that's not part of their research. But I meet lots of people who generally, and I have, and I'll tell you one example where I went to a very, I think it's cheesy, you know, and I thought when he said, I went with another archaeologist to a holy site, and there's a shop, and I find all shops cheesy, so I want to preface this by saying I generally mock. And I buy things from them. I buy teddy bears, heritage teddy bears, and heritage jam. But I generally mock sites. But this is a holy site, so
I know
a lot
about
of,
the jam.
But there's a lot of there's a lot of. I mean, it's a genuine a pilgrimage site for Catholics, particularly Irish Catholics go there. And it's really, you know, there's like 4 bajillion candles on sale. And we went in, and he said to me, he went something like, "Oh my word!" And I went, "Yeah, it's a bit much, isn't it?" You know, and I. Laughed, you know, and he went, no, it really touches me. It reminds me where I used to visit. I used to go on pilgrimage with my late wife, and I went, oh no, you know, I've put my foot in it so badly. And I said, oh, I'm sorry, I was just meant there's a lot here, a lot of candles here. And I totally, I want you to get the, I don't want to, I want to make, firstly, my point is, where I'm going with the question is, a lot of archaeologists are of faith. People of faith, and a lot of the sites we investigate do have those religious dimensions, either explicitly or not. Do you think it's therefore do you think your impression is, given the, you know, is it a good thing to be an archaeologist of faith, or do you think it's a contradictory thing?
It's a really great question. I think it depends on the person. Because I will say, conversely, there are a lot of rabbis who are atheists, but they still are able to do their job. Because our job is about exactly that. I think that if you are capable, if an archaeologist is of faith and they're capable of looking at sites through the lens, a critical lens, and being able to understand that what they're finding and what they're exploring, what they're working on, has nothing to do with their particular faith. And the reason I say it, and I'm gonna put on my rabbi hat here for a second, is because anyone can have a religion. You know, I know that you are an atheist, but anyone can have a religion. I could say my entire life that I'm a Jew. That doesn't mean that I have faith. That means I have a religion. It means that I have a prescribed set of rituals that I do because that's what I believe that I'm supposed to do. That doesn't mean I have faith. Faith is something else entirely. So faith cannot be easily shaken by the idea that you're going to go into a job that might actually push back on your religion. There is a difference between something that is going to push on my religion and something that is going to push on my faith. So if I were in a position where I was going into somewhere that I knew that this would question, one, I'm a Jew, so questioning things is what I do for a living. I came out of the womb going, why? That is what all Jews do. But if I knew it was going to question my religion, I want to push forward because I want to expound the boundaries of what I believe. If it's something that is going to shake my faith, then I have to ask myself, why is that? What is it about my faith that is so easily torn asunder? What is it? So, in terms of someone who is in the archaeological community, as long as they understand that it isn't their faith that's being questioned, it's just their religion, and they can separate the two, I think they'll do fine.
Wow, that's a fantastic answer. Thank you. I think I did the job. I have a further question, but maybe it's your turn to throw one at me. But that was
Go ahead. You said if you have a follow-up,
well,
go right ahead.
I was interested in whether either you want to visit or you've visited a site, not necessarily connected with your faith, but what archaeological site do you find most of any age from early 20th century back to early times, any site that you think is particularly powerful, or whether you visited it or not, I don't know. I was just interested in what your archaeological, if you
That's
have
a
any
really
archaeological.
wonderful question. And I say this a lot just because it's a occupational hazard. I get questions a lot, so I often am like, that's a great question. That's how I also start off with I'm going to teach you some Hebrew. So let's just okay. So for places I've visited, and I would like to point out, I've never gone anywhere. Let me just say that. I am not a well-traveled human being, but eventually I'm going to have all these children grow up and I'm going to do that. I'm going to be like, see ya. However, the two places that I have been that created the kind of awe that I am a person who, listen, this is just to give context to how I see the world. The eyes that I use to see the world, I cry at commercials. Okay, so let's just get that out there. Okay, we used to have these commercials here in the States about toilet paper called Charmin, and it would be this guy like getting mad at kids who were squeezing the Charmin, and I would start crying. I would be like, "Leave Mr. Whipple alone!" Like I was. So like I'm very. It does not take much to move me, is all I'm trying to say. I see something of beauty and I cry. I saw Rembrandt in person and like just broke down in tears. Like that is just how I see the world. So when I was about 15, my parents thought it was very important because I am indigenous, if anyone didn't know that, I am an indigenous woman, that they took me to the mission in San Diego. Which the missions out here in California were started by Father Serra. He was a Franciscan monk who helped convert indigenous peoples, my people, to Catholicism. And it was very much save the man, kill the Indian. So my mother and father thought it was very important that we visit these places to honor our dead, who are buried under these places. But when I tell you that I walked into this church and cried, not just because my people were underneath it, but because there was, I can still remember with explicit detail the way the wood felt on the pews. They had been worn down from so many people touching them and sitting on them over the years because they still sometimes would hold mass there. I could run my hand across the wood and feel just how it had worn down to this almost slick feeling. You know, you're just kind of like, oh, the cobblestone where you could see how where the people had kind of like, kind of rifled in when they were sitting. There were stones placed in the floor where it was grave markers to show who was buried under there, the monks, nuns, etc. And I walked around to the front, and Catholics love their stained glass panes, and yeah. So I've been there, and I've been to the one in Los Angeles, and the one in Los Angeles paled in comparison. It was still moving. It was still breathtaking and heart-shattering at the same time, because you still know as an indigenous person, your people are there. They shouldn't be there, and they are. But the one in San Diego, that was the, places I haven't been that I would love to, because I'm just like, I have to see it. Honestly, there's a few churches, like, I know I'm a Jew, don't at me, folks, but there are a few churches in England. There's one in Norway that I would love to see. There's one in Denmark that, like, I have seen just, like, it's this kind of gothic kind of structures that I'm just, that and Stonehenge, because who doesn't want to see Stonehenge?
I'm
Like,
sick of Stonehenge.
and I
No.
personally, come to think of it, I wouldn't also mind finding Cragna Dune, but I know that doesn't exist. That's an Outlander thing. But like, touch a stone and see if I can go back to 1776. I'm just saying, 17, yeah, you get it. Those would be, yes. But I'm afraid what would happen is I would be a mess. I would visit these places and I would just, have a bag and just whip out like the tissue and just. Yeah, when I still think about the one in San Diego, I drove by it not too long ago because I had to take my son to San Diego, and I drove by it, and just it's on this hill. You have to kind of drive up this windy road to get to it, but you can see it from the through thoroughfare. And I just am like, it just automatically like kind of sent me back. And plus, I remember the smells. How it smelled when you first just like walked into the church, and it was just like you're just hit with this like the incense that it feels like the incense has permeated into the wood all over the church from being, gone back and forth, and the faint smell of like the people who have come in and gone, and you can kind of smell whatever fragrance they were wearing or whether or not they smoked, like. Yeah, I have to go back to that one. That even though I'm a Jew and they have my people under there is something about it that just, yeah. So I guess that's my answer. And I'm sorry, I kind of went on a long rant there. I apologize for that. I
Really,
just kind of babbled on.
Lorraine's rightly saying here in the comments you would love Tintern Abbey in Wales, and that's true. You would, I mean, and Valle Crucis is a not as dramatic, but it is the one near me that I was mentioning earlier is also a gothic medieval church ruin. So, yeah, there's
Yeah,
plenty of
but
those.
what I
But
would cry is what you're t are, is what I'm being told is that I would cry. Is that what I'm understanding? That if I went to Tintern Abbey, would I just cry?
I don't know if that was her particular point, just that you'd love it, but I think
Probably.
it is a beautiful, it's an iconic structure, and it's so evocative as a ruin. And yeah, I mean, I must admit, there's been sort of funerary sites that have touched me in that somber way, like you're talking about. And I was actually, there have been many that touch you. And the thing about funerary sites is they're unpredictable, and you don't know what you're going to find on gravestones that'll move you in a particular way. And I am not the. I like to pretend I'm not emotional, but you do get touched by all manner of things. Yeah, so I certainly understand what you're saying about the, yeah,
Well, I have to
the.
ask you then the same question. What about you?
Oh, what was the question again? Oh, yes, about. Well, I suppose in terms of emotion, that particular issue of emotional connection, I think there's been some sites I've been to that are overwhelming. And just give you two examples. I mean, they're not anything linked to my research, and that's why I'm just saying as a personal thing is I was on an archaeological conference in 2015. Hang on, when am I talking about here? I've lost track of time. But anyway, whenever the hell it was, no, it's longer older than that. It was back in 2005. What am I talking about? Yeah, 2006. I've lost track. It doesn't matter. A Krakow in Poland. And they had various excursions associated with the conference, the European Archaeological Association conference. And I thought, yeah, I'll go to Auschwitz-Birkenau and see what that's like. And it was just, it was really, it was, yeah, I was there with a full-on academic group, and we were doing the academic, you know, how is the heritage being represented? It's heavy. It's really heavy. So
So,
there's that.
when I've never been to either, obviously. However, being raised my entire life as a Jew, you we're fed on stories of the Holocaust because that is like ingrained in our DNA. And so that kind of, I'm almost terrified actually to visit it. It's a place that I desperately would love to go, but I'm almost terrified to be there because partly is because the fact that I do have a condition called hyperosmia. So I have a heightened sense of smell. And I've already heard from people that you can still smell things. And my fear is that I will like just break down and cry and people have to carry me out and it would be ridiculous. I apologize. You did have one other site that you wanted to mention.
Well, I just want to quickly respond to that and say that it's not just the Schindler's List generation. Before then, you know, one's photographs, one's information one gains about those sites is utterly grey. And it was the most beautiful sunny day. Almost like, you know, the world was trying to defy you to see anything sinister in the landscape. Of course, it was, and it was just those, that was the most uncanny day. Because it was just so bright and blue sky, and not cloud, and it just felt so utterly, you know. I just wanted to add that. The other one, I'll tell you another one, was I was on another archaeological conference down your way, and not nowhere near you, but in southeast Arizona, and I got taken to Apache Pass, Fort Bowie, and the cemetery there has a host of graves. Which have been reconditioned and repurposed, so it's not, they're not really as they are. They're reproduced as from photographs. It's a bit of a deceit, but that's part of historic conservation. But one of the graves there that it has flowers, the only one that has flowers on it and seems to be visited to show respect is the grave of Little Robe, who's the son of
The
Geronimo.
son of Geronimo.
And so you have this kind of tiny little child's grave that has such a. Yeah, it was really, that was really touching. So it's, yeah, great. But there's, they're just two
That
examples of
one I've
many great.
seen.
What's that?
That one I've seen.
Oh, right. Okay. And I didn't expect that.
My family, when I was a child, my father used to do this thing once a year where he would say, "We're going on the epic family vacation." And one of those vacations took us through that way. Again, because indigenous, my parents wanted to make sure that I saw things and understood the history like of where I came from. So, yeah, that
Well,
was
I'm
one place we
delighted we
went.
found somewhere we've both been to, because actually, you know, it doesn't always happen with these things, you know, so.
That's actually kind of interesting. Yes. But yeah, I was there, but I was about 13, 14. Yeah, 13, 14. So I was
Well,
very, I was about the same height because, I stopped growing. But yeah, I was, but yes. And I remember we went through there. We went around to like the Grand Canyon, the whole thing. But like my dad said, "Oh, we're going to take this side trip." And like we drove all through there and that kind of thing.
so that's well, and that's you know, it ends up being grades, doesn't it, that touch one, or sites of death on a scale or a character that are you know, shall we say, you know, exceptional. That I think, but I mean, I have a there's a war mem there's a disaster memorial near me that touches me every time I go past it, and it never stops to be emotional for me. Is the Gresford mining disaster memorial, which is just down the road from me, where basically, you know, large numbers of miners were entombed alive, you know, in a when the pit caught fire, and so the pit head is the memorial, and it's one of many memorials to mining disasters across Wales and Scotland and Northern England and Midlands England. And it's just really harrowing because those graves were never recovered. So they are literally a mile deep and a mile out underneath that. They're not under that spot, but they're in the landscape as a sort of haunting ghost mm-hmm. on the community generations later. And the memorial is the only thing that sort of presences them. So I think...
So I have a question. I have one last question for you. This one popped up because Allie had this question. And then I was wondering, do you want to open it up in case anybody else had questions for us?
I think that's true. We've gone on quite a long while, but there seems to be an audience with us. We've got 10 people here. So I think it's very important, you know, if there are any. I mean, I've been trying to keep up with the comments and questions.
Yeah,
and
there's been a few.
You know, but maybe if we scroll back. But yes, I think we should. So I think I've asked you all the questions I was going to ask. So yeah, hit me with your last question.
What are modern archaeologists doing to rectify the Christian influence of their predecessors?
Sod all. Actually, of all the things and all the discussions, of all the discussions I've had about, in, you know, the decolonization and the racism within archaeology, one of the least touched on aspects is the huge role of the church, different churches, different, you know, influences on the way we think of the past. And I maybe I've missed it, and others can say, how would you just out of touch? There's been these massive conferences about the Christian biases. But I mean, it's been discussed as part of that package of the colonial and imperial legacies of British archaeology and its global, you know, influence. But I haven't, maybe I, again, I can't see everything and I haven't read everything and I don't know everything, but I think nothing, very little. And it's insidious and deep. And it's not because Christians are insidious and deep in the narrative. It's those framings of progression and superiority of Christianization and are still a problem. And so I have a lot of, while I see many pagans peddle quite simplistic narratives about Christian conversion and oppression that can have their own problems, they're only a drop in the, they're only a tiny fragment of a bigger problem, which is that untackled legacy of the church. And I think it's particularly church archaeology and medieval church archaeology is, you know, there's a lot of, and there's nothing wrong with it, that people of faith, of a Christian faith, who study church architecture and archaeology and art history, you know, I mean, it's inevitable they have a much better advanced knowledge of those subjects than those that don't. But I think there needs to be a more critical evaluation of that legacy. So I actually will say, and I'm happy to be shot down, nothing has been done on that issue directly and specifically, and there's still a lot of deference to the Christian tradition in medieval archaeology, you know, and I say deference to the and that's the difference. When we're talking about respect, we should be respectful of other faiths and religious sites. Archaeologists should work with local communities. We should work with sensitive or contested spaces that have different faith stories. We should be expect the unexpected, prepare for the worst in working. But remember that when we're working in a locality, it may have global ramifications, you know. So if we're working on a site that ends up, we don't even know it's going to be, but it ends up being, say, let's say, for sake of argument, a Jewish cemetery, and we didn't know it was going to be, that has a global implications that we can only, so we've got to act locally and be aware the ramifications could be global, all of these things. But there's no conversations about, because, yeah, we say, well, we've got to be respectful of beliefs, but there's a lot of over deference to the Christian legacy, by which I mean that we should be respectful of people's faiths, but that shouldn't make us deferential to narratives that should be questioned. I don't know if that makes sense. So, you know, the academic's job is not to write cozy just-so stories for Christianity and the church. And if it's we're working on a cathedral or we're working on a a long abandoned ancient site that may have had a church associated with it. Our job is not to write a cozy just so story about how these ancient Christians felt this or the ancient, or it could be of other faiths, let's say Jewish. Or, we are there to write the story, and to that can sometimes lead to some tense interactions. We should be respectful but not deferential, and I think that there was too much deference to, and it, what's the word, under the umbrella, under the cover of we must be respectful. And I think that is not our archaeologist's job, is not to indulge those cozy Christian parables.
I think
I don't
that's
know if
a
that.
really excellent answer. No, that was, I feel like that was guise. There it is, under the
Under the
guise. Yeah.
guise. That's it. Thank you. Thank you. I need people who are not first
Yes,
language
thank
English
you.
to actually tell me about the English language, because some of the words just go, boom. But then maybe that's wine, Cheers. Thank you. Thank you. I mean, in all sincerity, I meant thank you. I just.
Well, I find that apparently I don't speak English. I just speak American, which is not English. So,
I'm no
I
clue.
did see that there, I did see there was a question for me early on, which was why do Jews place a pebble on gravestones
Oh, I
when they
missed that
go to
one.
visit? That was the first question I saw. So I'm going to answer that very quickly. It
Oh,
is
yeah.
because we are telling the soul that we have been there, that we're telling the person who has passed that we have come to visit them, because flowers die. But stone is a permanent way of saying that you are still thought of, you are still kept in memory, and what is remembered lives. So we place the little pebble to remind them that they are thought of.
That's a fantastic answer. Thank you.
Pardon me, that was
Bless you.
terrible. I'm so sorry. Yeah, so that's why Jews place the pebble. We don't bring flowers.
And I've seen that at the Jewish memorial at the National Memorial Arboretum to British service personnel, Jewish ser British service personnel. And I've seen it in other places too. And I've seen it adapted by others. I've seen pebbles as not exclusively a Jewish thing, but I've seen it adapted, and I know in various other guises and uses. But I've also seen it on Jewish memorials. I've seen it on the Holocaust Memorial in Hyde Park and places like that. So it gets used in a whole variety of contexts.
Well, Jews believe we have this thing we say when someone passes. Baruch Dayan Ha'emes, or Ha'emet, depending on who passed. And it is not rest in peace. It is not like, I'm so sorry. It means blessed be the true judge. That we are blessing the person who passed, that they, when they sit with Hashem, Hashem blesses them because Hashem is the true judge. Then we say, may your memory be for a blessing. Meaning that the people who are still here, your memory lives on with us, so what is remembered lives, and may the memory of you always bless us. Then we say, we have like a three-part thing, Baruch Dayan Ha'ames. Then we say, may their memory be a blessing. And then we say, may your aliyah or your neshama have aliyah. So neshama is our soul. It literally means the soul of a person, neshama. And then aliyah means to go up, to be raised, to be like in the arms of Hashem, to be loved. So we say, may your neshama, may your soul find its way up to the arms of Hashem. And then we kind of do the thing. And then we don't put the pebble on until a year later. So it's a year after when we start to visit that we start Yahrzeit, the anniversary of that we start doing that. So I'm sorry, to answer that question, that's the answer. But I'm a rabbi and I'm long-winded and I can't just answer a question without like I have to teach a little because it's kind of it's in my DNA that like somebody asks a question and I'm like, well, and did you know? And I say that as if I speak Yiddish, but I'm Sephardic and so I don't.
I'm just going through the comments, and I saw just a quick qualification. Someone asked me a practical question about can you use LIDAR to look underneath the earth and see what's there? What you're thinking of ground premise? Ground premise. I'm just gonna, it's not alcohol.
Have another one, Professor.
Ground penetrating radar. It's a real thing, which is where you radar beneath the earth to see features. Doesn't work particularly well in heavily stony areas like Cairns, which is what the Pillar of Elise Egg is sitting on. LIDAR is basically bouncing a laser off the ground surface. So it's great for seeing features hidden by tree cover. So the Amazonian rainforest, you can see whole ruins that are hidden by tree cover, but you can't penetrate the earth with LIDAR. You're just bouncing lasers from an aeroplane over the ground to get a reading of topography. And it's taking out the vegetation cover. So it's great for forests and woodland and scrub that you can't see the archaeological features. But that's nothing to do with our conversation, but someone asked, so I thought I'd better say that. Someone is telling me about oh, there's so many great comments on here. Honestly, there's so many. I just realizing how many great, brilliant comments.
I
Nazareth
have
is just
one.
outside Basingstoke, of course, yes. That feminist witch lady, she does brilliant comments. Really good. Dr. Feminist Witch, really great comments. There's so many people coming on. Lorraine is coming up with great comments. And thank you. Thank you for all of this. I don't think there's any extra questions for me though. I think everyone's anything we haven't already covered, I mean, but
I
some,
have one. Auntie Spice asked me, and I saw it when I saw her do it. She asked if the Torah actually talks about whether or not there are actual dinosaurs, whether or not the Torah speaks to dinosaurs. And the truth is, no, not in the way that we know what dinosaurs are. So the Torah talks about beasts of the land, beasts of the sea, things of that nature. It does not say, these ginormous like beasts. But what happens is the Hebrew gets translated into English. And again, because I'm a rabbi, here goes the hat. One Hebrew word, it takes like a paragraph and a half to explain in English. Now, if you're a Jew or you understand Hebrew, someone could say like, great, I have a great point. Erev. The word Erev means, we use it to mean the night before. Erev Shabbat. Erev Pesach. Erev. It means the evening before, but it doesn't actually mean evening because we don't have a word for evening in Hebrew. So Erev means the space between heartbeats, the space between breath, the space between. But if you're a Jew, you get that. Erev Shabbat. Erev Pesach. But when you have somebody who isn't knowledgeable or they just hear Erev or you say Erev Tov, like good evening. And Hebrew is like Yoda. We speak kind of backwards. Like, so Erev, like meaning evening, Tov, good, you put it together. But Erev does not mean in English what people think it means in English. And that is true for all Hebrew because you have a word that comes from another word. We have this root word and then it branches off and there's like 17 different meanings from it. And that is kind of what happens with when Hebrew is then translated into English. That's where we start to have the issues. And then if you take a text like the King James Version of the Bible, which was translated 9 different times because King James was like, I don't like it. It doesn't say what I want it to say. Do it again. The loss in translation just becomes wider. The divide between what the Hebrew says and what the English makes it say are over here. So in simplest terms, no, there's nothing like that in the Torah.
One thing you were going to ask me about, I don't think you ever did, was about symbolism and symbols. Do we want
I
to do
did, I
that, or have you
did.
got any?
Yeah, I got time, but I'll ask you again.
I can't remember exactly what
I
I don't know.
said, I
It's too tough.
said, see, you've had too much wine. See?
No. There's never, I don't want viewers, dear viewers, I am not an alcoholic. I have perfect
No
control of
one
the amount of
thinks you're an
alcohol I.
alcoholic.
It's only once every literally 24 hours that I get completely hammered. It's perfectly fine for archaeologists. The ancient past soaks up the alcohol, so I'm only drinking just water, really.
Did you say the ancient past?
The ancient past, because I'm connected to history. So like, the past soaks up the alcohol for me. Doesn't that make sense? That's science. My God, what am I dealing with here?
That is not
logic.
I don't think that's how that works.
No,
I don't think that's how that works, Professor.
I'm sure it. When you're drunk, it's what happens. It's lost.
So my earlier question was
the absorbent. It's
there
absorbent.
Are so often that people use symbolism. The ancient past soaks up the alcohol. That one, I'm gonna have to remember that. I didn't realize it was that absorbent.
I'm not inebriated. It's antiquity making me happy.
It's antiquity. So, my question was in regards to symbolism.
Okay.
When people take their symbolism and they make it mean something that it doesn't actually mean throughout history, like Thor's hammer. It was a baiting question, I'm aware, but I know recently you have gone over a lot in terms of Vikings and a lot of people who are Norse faith practitioners who want to say, no, the hammer is this. I saw one of your videos where you said it literally just says hammer. Like it didn't, the hammer, it just said hammer. We don't know what it meant. It just literally translated to hammer. And so I think how do you feel about these people who take things that have been scientifically proven because it's a part of their faith and they're like, no, it's sort of like the biblical archaeology, but in reverse. How do you feel about people who take and say, no, this symbol I know means this, even though it's been proven otherwise?
Okay. So, I mean, this is, again, a delicate issue, which goes back to my earlier points about respect and reverence. Deference versus respect. I respect that people take symbols from a range of places and use them in different ways. Sometimes we accuse this of cultural appropriation. Sometimes we accuse this of people just being ignorant of the history of that use. But as an archaeologist, my job is not to correct people or police the symbols, but I can at least provide a constructive source of information about what we actually know about these symbols. And when it's a symbol of one of the world faiths, you can see such archaeology provides context on the fluctuating and varying use of those words. So the Christian cross in early medieval Wales, for example, we have on carved stone monuments is the principal source of evidence for the whole of Wales in the early Middle Ages, from the 5th to 11th centuries. All those centuries, most of the traces, we have a few manuscripts, we have a few artefacts with Christian crosses, but for those 6-7 centuries, most of our knowledge for Christianity from Wales comes from carved stone crosses. And the crosses are of all different types, shapes and sizes. And some of them have been reinvented in the 19th century, inspired by those ancient monuments. And so a lot of the crosses in the Celtic tradition in Wales are archaeological objects that have been analysed, studied, and then regenerated back into a concept of a Welsh church and a Welsh identity. So all of our war memorials for the First World War, when the poor the Welsh Guardsmen who were bombed when they were still in their, in the Falklands War, which I'm not going to comment on the politics of, but Welsh Guards never got off the boat when they were hit by an Exocet fired at them. And many of them burnt to death and there were terrible injuries. And their memorial is in the form of a 10th century cross, that is in Carew in Pembrokeshire. So our modern memorialization comes from these ancient objects. If you don't understand that, if you think that there's just like an arcane tradition, I'm using Christianity in Wales as my analogy here. If you believe there's some kind of static in spiritual and cultural embedded fixed symbolism of Christianity in Wales, because you don't understand that someone in 1987, remembering the Falklands conflict, put up a cross inspired by a 10th century cross. If you don't understand that kind of stuff, that the ancient past, ancient monuments are informing our present. If you don't understand that the first time that the Thor's hammer pendants were excavated by archaeologists and then determined to be thought to be Thor's hammer was in 1870. You think there's some kind of some unbroken tradition of some old Swedish woman or old Norwegian man in some distant fjord who just preserve knowledge of what these objects were? Then you're a bit of a child in intellectual terms. That's what I'm saying. That's a bit patronising, but it's true. You've got to understand, if you're using this symbol, you need to understand where the symbols got their attributions, how they've been repurposed, sometimes by faith groups, sometimes by extremists, sometimes by a mess of different terrible people in the 20th and 21st centuries. And when it comes to symbols...
I have a follow-up.
Sorry, go on.
No, go on. Babble on. Let me know when you're done, and then I have a follow-up.
But then when you get... So my final point was, but when you get to symbols that have literally been used by the most heinous regime that almost everyone globally knows and is being actively mobilised by those that want to adhere to that 1930s, 1940s regime across the globe, as a pan, you know, it's a global issue. And you just go, no, for me it means X, and it doesn't, that has nothing to do with that. And you go, that's not good enough, is it? You know, and that's why it's about, it's our responsibility, not only the users of those symbols, but the broader communities discussing those, to be aware of that complex history. Or, and I'm afraid that is an academic aspect, but it's work, it's intellectual work, in the same way that you cannot, you know, you cannot engage with the complex stories of the Christian faith, the Jewish faith, the Muslim faith, without having some basic fundamentals of historical and archaeological knowledge. And I'm afraid we're not giving it to kids. You know, they're getting some religious education, they're getting some history, but they're not getting a grounding in this. And so that's why we're having to waste our time on TikTok or YouTube or social media doing this. And I at one level, I think it's a fundamental failing of our education system. Another level, it's why archaeology is important. I'm not saying people are wrong in using these symbols, but we need to be responsible and aware of those histories. And if we're not, we can't just innocently say, well, I didn't know it had that. You know, I'm using a skull goblet. You know, if someone told me, do you realize that there's various counter-reformation Czech Republic crypts that use that. I go, yeah, I know. That's what I'm doing. I'm using the macabre in a knowing way, knowing it's not offending anyone because it's such a well-known tourist site, and knowing the history of skull use within a host of traditions in post-Reformation Europe. Right, I'm aware of that, right? If I just go, oh, it's just a bit creepy, I'll just have a skull goblet, then it's a bit dumb. But it's not really offending anyone because skulls are ubiquitous. But if it was a specific symbol and I knew what it was and I just went, oh, it's just innocent fun, you know, no, it doesn't wash. And that's why we're in a complex world where we've got to be aware of these symbols and their associations. So that was a rant. I'll shut up.
No, it's okay. But I have a follow-up for it. This one I didn't tell you about. I didn't warn you, so I apologize for that. I have seen recently on this app where certain people believe that they have a right to have certain symbols that belong in probably museums, probably for everyone to enjoy. But they think that because it's a part of their faith that they should have these items for themselves, almost akin to, I would say, grave robbing. Would you care to address your thoughts on that subject?
Okay. So I know what you're talking about. You're being very careful of what you're saying. But this is about that sense of... There's a long tradition of particularly white aristocratic males and others, but mainly them, thinking they have a right to own and are the benevolent custodians of not only other human beings, but cultural objects from other, including human remains from other people's cultures. And these are, I say it that way because it is part of a spectrum of entitled colonial supremacist thinking. You're not, these people work in your fields and they pick your whatever cotton or whatever, but you're a benevolent custodian of them. You care for them, you look after them. And you see the same, and this is a bit rhetorical, but this, you see the same language being used by private collectors who, oh, I just saw it on the internet, they must have a right to sell it. I'm looking after that object. I'm respecting that object. You're not, you know. There's enough questions about whether any museums should have these objects, right? And these are healthy and good debates we should be having in about whether nationally funded institutions who are legally have responsibility for those objects should have those objects. So if you think it's okay to buy and sell grave goods that have been acquired, and you don't, and you say, oh, they came with a certificate of authenticity, so they must be okay. You know, not only are you fooling, you're a fool, you're not only a fool, but you're a dangerous fool, because we are living in a world where there's been a 150, 200 years in international trade in antiquities and human remains. That, you know, human remains and objects that are from graves are being robbed across the world. And war zones, as I've said in many a TikTok, war zones, including the Ukraine, we're seeing Russian state-sanctioned cultural genocide by the extraction of Ukrainian objects from Scythian, from Roman, from all different periods of Ukraine's history, including Viking Age. Objects now being taken for safety out of Kherson and Mariupol and elsewhere to Russia.
You know, I can right now, without even
private
thinking,
trade as well.
I can tell you another group of people who did the same exact thing. Taking cultural items from folks because they thought they needed it for safekeeping.
Just looking after them.
Circa Germany, like 1940 something or other.
And it's out of the same playbook. It's mainly with the same. Not, I mean, it's always everyone. You know, it's the same playbook. And the problem is, if you are, I mean, I think in that particular case that and Crazy Cat Lady has said it is that Berserker Bear and his clan example. I think genuinely it was a lot of just genuine, you know, utter ignorance of what was involved. I mean, almost it was childlike in the naivety. But it's part of a bigger problem that in a global world with an internet source, if you are spouting out and promoting the acquisition of such items, you know, you say, well, how are there bigger problems in the world? There are starving children. There's this. Yeah, of course, it's always a bigger problem. But in terms of my expertise, in terms of objects that come from sacred sites, holy sites, funerary sites, we've got to do better. And we should be, it shouldn't be difficult to just say the default is, you know what, today I'm not going to do, you know, I'm not going to run anyone over in my car, and I'm not going to go on the internet and buy some object that I don't know where it's from, but it could have been looted from an archaeological site. It's like not complicated, you know. It's like, do I want, you know, a DVD of a Star Wars film, or do I just want to buy another bee to stick in my beard that comes from an archaeological site? It's a tough decision, but, you know, maybe I'll just go for the DVD. And then there's, you know, it's, you know, it does beg a belief that we have to keep going over this again and again in the archaeological world. And I suppose archaeologists, again, going back to my earlier point, sound like we're a bit on a high horse here and patronising and stuff. And so I am happy to be patronising on some topics. And I said context matters. On some topics, I'm really hardline. And I say, and I'm quite vociferous on this. And I am hardline. And other issues, I see, well, there's two sides to the story. Maybe they didn't know. No, I looked at the website he got it from. It was clear to anyone with half a brain cell. This is all remetalled. You know, either the objects are fake or they are looted, you know, and there's no in between, really. So my view is that that whole situation sucked. And he got all he deserved. And if anything, I was merciful in limiting the number of videos I covered on it. But, you know, in other cases where it's human remains and it's people with walls of spines on their back wall, they're still going strong. They've still got a bone trade going on TikTok. And many archaeologists have called them out. And we can't stop it, but we can at least try and spread the word that there is, you know, just how despicable these behaviours are. You know, we don't sell human beings, live or dead. It's not complicated. You know, why is that a controversy? I remember seeing someone ages ago going on this app. If I turned up and saying eating people is wrong, someone would come and go, huh, this guy thinks he knows how to tell people that eating people's wrong. And, you know, before you know it, and, you know, it's that level of, you know, it's that level of dumb, isn't it? And you can't fight against it, but at least we can be a small voice saying our stance on these issues.
I love it. That was perfect. No, you know, I expected nothing less, actually. I just wanted to, you know, mostly kind of just go over it for people who might come across this kind of thing out in the world and understand, yeah, that's not really the best idea. Now, I did get a question. Hold on. got to put on my reading glasses. Hold on. Ah, Alistair Michael, talking of symbols, care to comment on the scene of the mummy with Benny and the 7L symbols / prayers? Now, I'm assuming by 7L, you're talking about Hebrew when he's trying to get Imhotep to leave him alone. So he's holding up, you know, when he's speaking in Chinese, and then he starts speaking in Hebrew, and here comes Imhotep and says, "Ah, the language of the slaves." You know, this is what I'm assuming is what you're getting at. The thing is that, as I said earlier, and I don't know if you were here at the time when I said it, we were never slaves in Egypt. Oh, and come for me. I know what's going to happen. I know people are going to come for me. But we were never actually slaves in Egypt. There is no scientific data to support the idea that at any time were we as Jews, as Hebrews, as Israelites, were we slaves in Egypt. We did not help build the monuments. We did not help build the temples. We did not help build the pyramids. Historical record shows that the slaves who did that were Egyptian, not Jew. So it's a bit of fun, you know, as most media is. Like, Mummy is probably in my top 10 list of all-time favorite movies. You can miss me with the third one. Whatever. And I like Maria Bello, but still, miss me with that third one. If it's not Rachel Weisz, I don't want to watch it. But it's fantasy. And that's what I'm getting at. Like, all he's basically saying is he says a little Hebrew, and it's supposed to be there to try and tie together the idea that Imhotep is actually Egyptian, that he lived at the time of the Hebrew slaves, that kind of, you know, that's what it is. It's okay. Now I'm going to tell you, Judean cupcake. So Davida down here, professor, is a friend of mine. So she says the Mummy is the best bi-panic film of all time. And I'm going to say this. I am 196% gay. The other 4% is pretty much Brendan Fraser. Like, it's not. But I just have to say that. The 196 is Rachel Weisz. I mean, she was in a Jewish movie not too long ago where she was a full-on lesbian, and I thought I was going to lose my mind. I was just not okay for like the rest of the week after I saw that movie. I was, whew. Anyway, but I think what happens is sometimes we see movies, and if we have no context to them, we think their actuality, you know? Okay, so Constantine also is up there in my top 10 of, like, Constantine's a good one. Anyway, I'm sorry, I got a little distracted. Rachel Weisz does that to me. But in terms of that particular scene, it's just supposed to give us context to show that, you know, Imhotep is exactly Egyptian, and he was at the time of the, you know, the Hebrews were slaves. But we have no cultural context, or we have no cultural, like, data to support that, not even a little bit. But it's supposed to be fun. That's literally what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be, like, this kind of fun. You're not supposed to take it seriously. You know, you're just supposed to enjoy it for what it is. You know, it's definitely not a historical document. It's just, yeah. And Benny is epic, you know?
I love it.
You know, you have that scene where he's like, I understand you had you have a new friend. And he's just like, you know, you're my only friend. Oh, yes. I will agree with Davida here. Can the goyim, by the way, is not pejorative, professor. Goyim literally just means other nation. Unfortunately, a lot of goy believe that to call someone a goy is pejorative. Now, it can be used pejorative. I could be like, you damn goy, you know, like, but in general context, it just means someone who is not. Can the goyim please stop treating Prince of Egypt like it's theirs, okay? So here's the thing, and I'm going to kind of disagree with you for a minute, Davida, please don't hate me, and here is why. Because While I disagree that Christianity is an Abrahamic faith, I do not see Christianity as an Abrahamic faith because there are only two sons of Abraham, and that is Isaac and Ishmael. And Ishmael is who the religion of Muslim, Islam came from. And Isaac is who Jews would come from. But that's why I don't consider Christianity an Abrahamic faith, because they separated themselves from us when they decided Christ was their Moshiach, their Messiah. I don't actually begrudge them, though, the idea of the Prince of Egypt, because, like, who doesn't want, I mean, for an animated movie, it is a really, 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 really good movie. I mean, like, not to surprise you, as I told you earlier, I cry at like toilet paper commercials. Obviously, I cried at this movie. You know, come to think of it, is there a movie I haven't cried at? Like, let's just be, if I'm being real. Like, I actually, did you say no? Yeah, there's not a movie I haven't cried at. Are we talking about the movie? Because it's a bop. Yes, it's, of course it's a bop. Yeah, hi, Ash.
It's Ash.
It is. It is a bop. That's just, yeah. But in terms of like media like that, and most often you will see in media Hebrew being said, and it's not correct Hebrew. And a good representation of that is, I saw an ad.
Ash is in the house indeed. Hi, Ash. Good to see you.
Oh, I saw an ad here on TikTok not too long ago, and it was like a charger for your phone. You could set it down, and when you set it down, it lit up, and it had all of this Hebrew written around it. It looked like it came out of the show Supernatural, that kind of thing. And I got questioned, Rabbi, what does the Hebrew say? And I'm like, let me see it. Not a damn thing. That's what it says. It's just random letters. It was just literally random letters in a circle to make it look spiritual, to make it look mystical, to make it look, you know, witchy or whatever the hell they were trying to do with it. But it literally said nothing. And oftentimes that's what happens. Or they speak Hebrew, but they don't say the prayers correctly, either because they don't know how or they think they're being, you know, respectful. I've seen a lot of movies that depict Jews, and they're like, you can always tell when someone knows how to speak Hebrew versus not, because they'll say, Baruch! You know, Baruch! And I'm like, oh. I know my Hebrew is not that great, but come on now. Yeah, it's literally never correct Hebrew. But again, it's supposed to be, you know, fantasy. It's supposed to take you away from reality. So, you know, you're not supposed to take it too seriously. And now I babbled, so I'm going to apologize and just stop now.
I mean, we it's inevitable that any discussion comes back to Rachel Weiss and Brendan Fraser when we deal with archaeology. So I think we've finally got to a point where, you know, the inevitable conclusion is Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz, thank you very much. Good night. But I mean, my point is, I don't have anything else to add to. It's been a really fascinating discussion. I've learned a lot, and it's been very insightful. And I hope those that have stayed along have enjoyed it. And thank you so much, Rabbi, for your insights and for asking me tough questions that I struggle to answer. And
that's kind of my job.
Seem well.
It was. I appreciate the invite. This was. I loved the discussion. I feel like I have also come away with like nuance and understanding of your job that I didn't have before. And hopefully, other people get the idea that there doesn't have to have this parallel between religion and archaeology. The two can kind of intersect and pay up,
Howard, says Lorraine. I don't know. Maybe I have to send some kind of, I don't know.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I forgot about that. But yeah, that was earlier. I said I would pay good money for a Dancing Howard video. I didn't say it. Someone else said it. And I just agreed. I think that's a good idea. And somebody said we were going to start a GoFundMe. No, don't dance. You're going to dance like a white man.
No, I don't dance like a white man. I dance like a dinosaur riding archaeologist. Okay, whatever the heck I'm talking about now is lost to me.
That's a
So,
white man. I mean, you're talking to somebody who, used to be a professional ballroom dancer. So, like, you probably dance like a white man.
I dance badly. Is that
He says I dance badly. I'm sorry. I can't. Yeah, badly. Yeah, I'm sure you do. But that's okay. I mean, I expect that from white people. Like, I expect the getting the pizza, like spinning the
How dare you call
pizza
me white?
or
I bet you'll
doing
be
this
calling
bit.
me British next. I'm just
I'm sorry, did you want me to call you British?
No, I'm just being
Is
silly.
that
I'm
better,
just being
or
silly.
is it the English or Welsh?
No, I'm just being silly. I'm just being silly. It's
I
perfectly
know.
fine. Dancing around the
Yes,
dancing stones.
non-crazy
Okay,
cat. Yeah,
non-crazy.
it was a non-crazy cat lady who
Yep.
suggested that we needed a Dancing Howard video. So.
I'm gonna record it one day. It's coming, okay? But it'll need as much alcohol as I've had already,
Oh,
but
hold on. What is every Jewish holiday? You know what? That is a great question. I think that's what she said. Hold on. Judean cupcake. What is every Jewish holiday? You know what every Jewish holiday is, Howard? Oh, I'm sorry,
no.
Professor. It is. They tried to kill us. We survived. Let's eat. In fact, most Jewish holidays revolve around drinking. We have
Wow.
the we have Yeah, more wine, exactly. Purim, we are supposed to drink so much alcohol we cannot tell the difference between the worlds. We don't know if we're on earth or in Olam Haba. On Passover, we sit after we have fasted all day, by the way, and drink 4 glasses of wine before we eat.
Okay.
And same with
Well,
every Shabbat. Every Shabbat, we're supposed to drink.
I think I'm too lightweight to be a Jew. So
That's okay. I just want to thank you. I'm sure it's very late where you are. I
it's
appreciate
very early and late. Yes, it's on the edge of early now. It's great. It's great.
I appreciate you spending time with me. This was an amazing I think we did a lot of I love the questions you had for me, and hopefully mine were not too
Oh, fantastic. Thank you.
pedantic.
No, really great. Really great.
So I appreciate everybody who had questions in the comments. Hope maybe we could do another round of this at some point.
I did have a request for a more a later one from US based Norse pagan. So I think maybe we should perhaps do a follow up, but early morning for me and later for you, if you have the if that is ever
That
possible.
would be
But
fine. Yeah.
we'll sort something
Yeah.
out.
As long
So
as
for
I
more
know
wine.
ahead of time, I can plan it out.
Brilliant.
I
But
would love
thank you
to.
so much, Rabbi, and thank you all for being here for the full 2 and a bit hours. It's been an epic journey through
Well,
faith
what
and
do you? This
archaeology.
is what happens. Jews, we like to talk. Apparently, English archaeologists like to talk.
We try.
So there we go. Thank you so much, guys. You have a wonderful night.
Take care, everyone. Thank you again. Bye now.
If you've enjoyed this Archaeo Death video, why not check out the Archaeo Death blog at howardwilliamsblog.wordpress.com?